Sorry, I was. I probably thought all of those jokes were way funnier than everybody else. I hadn't seen his talk before, so I didn't know what he said. I'm going to make fun of you, and he didn't quite specify how, so I'm okay with it. And in truth, if I had to pick something to be when I was younger, if I can grow up to be an engineer, I would say I want to be as clever as Jacques, and I want to be as funny as Michael. But I got none of those things. Unfortunately, all I got was just being really, really good looking. So that is my burden to bear, and I will bear it alone. Oh, source code. Wow.
Put it back. Live code.
Live code? Oh, I've done too many presentations in live code. I know better than that. I should start off in, I want to say thank you to Ryan Burgess. Can I get a round of applause? Thank you. He wrangled all of us very different engineers to create a talk about performance. But there was one thing he said, because I gave a talk 2 years ago with Jock, actually, and he said, Jem, I will let you give another talk to redeem yourself after the last talk, but you are not allowed to make any Fast and Furious references. None. None whatsoever. So I said, okay. Okay. I won't. But I did anyway, so, you know, freedom and responsibility. I can do whatever I want. But I also want to thank, besides Vin Diesel for being so muscly, I aspire to be like him one day. But I also want to thank the SideOps team at Netflix. They are the hidden team that keeps the code running, and they have helped me more times than I can think, and they're one of my favorite teams, and they never get any credit. And you're probably like, who's SideOps team? I'll tell you later, you know, later in the talk. And I also want to thank my manager, Ryan, who's also my manager and my friend, my director, CSA, and everybody for coming out. So thank you for coming out and listening. I'm the last talk, so don't worry if you're getting a little sleepy. It's okay. I'll try to keep the excitement going. And right now you're probably thinking, that's weird to start a talk with thank yous. Those usually go at the end, don't they? But yeah, but this is a different kind of talk. I'm a different kind of engineer, in case you haven't noticed. You see, I could give a talk about Fast and Furious, which would be funny. Or I can give a talk about Netflix and all the engineering work we do and some of the big things we do, like how we can fail over millions of users from one AWS region to another in under 8 minutes. Amazing. Or I can give a talk about, I don't know, how we fit 25 hours of video in a gigabyte. Give a talk about that. That's awesome. That is groundbreaking stuff. But that's not going to help you. You don't work for Netflix, probably, most of you. You probably don't work for a streaming video platform. Some of you may have just graduated college. Some of you work in a 10-person startup. Some of you work at corporations that are 10 times the size of Netflix. So giving you precise details and technical implementations about how we did those things isn't really going to help you. What I want to do tonight is I want to talk about ideas. I want to talk about people. I want to talk about the people behind the code. Because behind every big concept that we have, behind every breakthrough, behind every big revolution that pushes things a little bit forward is a person. There's a person behind that. And that's what we believe in Netflix. We believe in people and not a single idea. So tonight I'm going to tell you three stories. Three stories about performance, engineering performance, from both the engineer and in terms of code. I'm going to tell you a story about Light, Tony and the Light Project, how he made Netflix.com 50% faster. I want to tell you about the Faster Things Project, making TVs not crash by fixing a UI issue. And I'll tell you about Atticus, bringing stability to an inherently unstable system. And I know what you're thinking. Netflix is this $163 billion tech company. You probably have tons and tons of engineers. And yeah, we're a fairly substantial tech company. But there's actually more people in this room than there are in our entire engineering team, or our entire UI engineering team. I know, it's surprising to most people that people think we're just large 10,000 engineers, but we're, you know, we've got, what, 150, 160 UI engineers? And that's across every TV, every laptop, every desktop, every phone, every tablet, every single place that you see Netflix is just a few engineers. So tonight I want to tell the story of just three. Three engineers who had an idea. simple ideas. But these were big ideas. These were ideas that were game changers. And they solved these million-dollar problems, probably multi-million-dollar problems. And it was really, really simple. At the end, you'll think, oh, wow, I would have thought of that. And maybe you would have. Because what I really want to teach you is how we think about these problems. Because again, you don't work for probably a streaming video company. So if I tell you a solution, you might take that, and that'll last you today, but it won't last you tomorrow. I want to teach you how to think about the problems that you're going to face tomorrow, and next week, and next year. But what I really want to teach you is how things work, how engineering actually works. My name is Jem Young. I'm a senior software engineer here at Netflix. And the other day, I had a meeting with my director, and I said, Chris, I've been here for almost 3 years. Can I finally change my title to Young Software Engineer? Because, you know, I'm a young software engineer, and I feel a little old every day. He said no. So here I am. But I tell people I'm a senior software engineer, and they think, oh, wow, that means you write a lot of code, right? You're far more productive than a junior engineer. And, but of course, less productive than the mythical rock star engineer who I've never met, but apparently from all the recruiting emails, they must exist. You know, they're hiring for rock star engineers. But really, I spend most of my time trying not to write any code. I am really lazy. I am the laziest engineer in Netflix. And I am proud of that fact. A good day for me is when I just go to a meeting and eat lunch and go home. I don't have to write any code at all. And that's the truth. And it seems weird, but I talked to one of my managers, Michael Ransdell, on the AUI team, and he gave me this quote that has always stuck with me. He said, actually, the more senior you get, the less code you write. And ideally, you look for ways to avoid writing code entirely because that's where bugs come from. Which is true. We have the data to back that up. The more code we write, the more bugs there are. It's actually a 1-to-1 ratio. For Michael, it's probably like 4-to-1 bugs to code. Do our best. So if we can't measure the performance of an engineer, if we can't see what value they are by the lines of code that they write, how do we know what a good engineer looks like? How do we know if someone is doing their job properly? How do we know if they're worth even working here at Netflix? It's a hard problem. And in truth, I'll be really honest with you. I don't have an answer. But what I can tell you is that it's not engineering performance. It's human performance. I don't have a one-shot silver bullet like Jock was describing earlier. I can't tell you this prescriptive way of, if you do this, if you get this MacBook and you wear gray jeans and this black shirt and grow a beard, you will become a better engineer. I can't give you some sort of formula like that. But I can tell you how to make the people better. I can tell you how to make the engineers that are all around you better. Oh, you were still twitch streaming that whole time? Wow. Dedication.
It looks better this way.
Tonight I have 3 stories to tell. The Light, Faster Things, and the Abacus Project. And I want to start with the Light Project because that was the most controversial. That is actually the one that the engineer behind it spoke about at the last JavaScript meetup. And it made a lot of people angry. So of course I'm going to bring it up again because, you know, all press is good press, as they say. And I can't talk about the Light Project without talking about the engineer behind it. Meet Tony. Tony is a senior software engineer here at Netflix. And Tony, he had a hard problem. You see, Tony was leading one of our performance teams. And it's an optional team. If you care about performance, such as myself and the other speakers, you can join this team and say, I want to make Netflix faster. And one of Tony's jobs was to make Netflix.com faster. Easy, right? Anybody can do it. Well, no, because Tony knew that Netflix runs on thousands of devices in dozens and dozens of languages in almost every country around the world. So to say, hey, I'm going to walk in and make Netflix faster, no. Because Tony's been here for a few years. He understands that where most people see a landing page with buttons and text, Tony sees this hidden complexity underneath. He sees the results of countless A/B tests and hundreds of engineering hours and that really smart people put into it to make this site as performant as possible. So when you say, hey, make this thing faster, that's not that easy. So where do we start? We tried a lot of things. And I shouldn't say we tried a lot of things. We failed at a lot of things. That's OK. But we tried looking at Brotli versus gzip, different compression algorithms. Didn't really do much for us. We tried looking at different ways of serving image assets. Like, I even had a wild idea of streaming an image over a WebSocket. It didn't really pan out. A lot of wasted time on that one. We even tried preloading our JavaScript, getting it to run a little bit higher in the stack so that CPU-constrained devices would execute the job faster and make sure that the page is rendered faster. None of these things worked. We got some wins here and there, but it wasn't that take-home, home run, silver bullet, whatever you want to call it. It wasn't the big win that we all thought we'd get when we started. So what do you do when you're stuck? What do you do when you've tried every single thing possible and you're just like, I'm out of ideas? Well, you look for inspiration outside. You look for things that aren't engineering. Go on vacation. Go for a run. Go do a hobby. And in this case, Tony's hobby was a car. This is Tony's car, called Pegasus, which, by the way, is a great name for a car, I was about to say, Pegasus. But Tony is he's a car person. Besides being a great engineer, he loves his car. And one thing that every single car person knows is that it's not the size of the engine, it's the weight of the car. In fact, Colin Chapman, the founder of Lotus Cars, once famously said, simplify, and then add lightness. And yes, I'm aware of the irony that it is a Ford Mustang, which is a very heavy car. We talk about light cars. But the Mustang could be fast if we made it lighter. And our application could be faster if we made it lighter. Because what Tony understood was that it's outside of the network requests, it's not the scripting, it's not the loading time, it's not the painting time, it is the scripting time. It is the sheer amount of time it takes to parse and execute all of that JavaScript that's the slowest part of a page. We had a radical idea. He sat us down in a meeting and said, hey, I want to try something. And this is something that we hadn't even thought of before. He said, I want to take out everything. I'm like, take out what? He said, everything. Everything. Everything that the client does not need to interact with the page or render the page. So that means on the server side, we're going to use React to render the template, because React is great. It lets me write pages really, really quickly. But we're not going to send it down to the client because we just don't need it. And we're going to take out Lodash. We're going to take out every single bit of JavaScript that does not need to be there. And we're going to strip it down. And we're going to make it fast. And you know what? It worked. It made Netflix.com 50% faster just by taking out everything that wasn't necessary. Sorry, emphasize. 50% faster. That is incredible. That was mind-blowing. And at the time, it was revolutionary. No one had thought of, let's just take out all the JavaScript. And I'm like, what do you mean? I write JavaScript. I'm mildly offended by that. No job security. But, but what he did was incredible. And he had this idea that came from somewhere other than software engineering. There wasn't some prescriptive way of coming around this. He just had to think about the problem differently. And 50% faster, it's a lot. If I made 50% more money, I could probably afford to finally buy a house. Actually, $2 million a bedroom. No. I take that back. We live in a magical place. But what Tony taught us is that it's the code that we don't write. We spend so much time measuring and analyzing and trying to weigh the pros and cons of each library. But he taught us it's the code that we don't write that's far more important. And that's a lesson that I still take today. So that was making Netflix.com faster. But now I want to talk about making TVs faster. TVs are, you probably didn't know, but they're really slow. They are really, really slow. My phone probably has more processing power than all the TVs in this room. Not joking. I want to talk about the Faster Things project. And one of that was making TVs faster and preventing crashes. And of course, I can't talk about making things faster without talking about the engineer behind it. Meet Joey. Joey is a senior software engineer at Netflix. Some fans of Joey out there. And besides being one of the nicest people you will ever meet, Joey has something you should know about him. He's a hacker. And no, I don't mean that kind of person who wears a tie and a baklava to hack computers, because that's important. Everybody knows this. No, Joey's a hacker in the truest sense of the word. He's a hacker in that he has won not one, not two, not three, but 4 Hack Day trophies here at Netflix. And if you know anything about the caliber of the engineers here, that is not an easy thing to do. It's like winning 4 gold medals in the Olympics. Or actually making it to a World Cup final like the US, you know? It'd be amazing. Someday we'll make it. But Joey, he was tasked with a problem. He needed to solve a crashing issue on TV devices. And that seems a little weird. But Joey's like, okay, first thing you need for any project is a cool name. Faster Things, a great project name. The next thing to do is we need to understand the problem. And the problem was that TVs around the world, on some of the lower end, they were crashing. And when a TV crashes, it can do weird things. Some might even say stranger things. So Joey spent time thinking about the app. He studied the app and tried to understand how things move from screen to screen. And what he figured out was, well, when I see a screen like that, to get that nice, smooth transition from screen to screen that looks beautiful, the TV actually needs to render both screens at the same time and then slowly move one off screen at the other time. And that's fine. It works. It's a beautiful experience. And I would argue with anybody, and fight me in real life if you have a problem, I would say that Netflix has some of the best designs out there. They're clean, they're efficient, they're fast, they work. But Joey said, there's something wrong with this, because I have studied this. I've studied the system as a whole. I've took a step back and understood that one of the constraints on any TV system is the memory, specifically the video memory. For instance, did you know that an Xbox 360 device, that's not terribly old, has 512 megabytes of system memory? Not video memory, system memory. So we have to render an entire experience in a very, very constrained environment. And video memory was the problem here. So Joey, he had a radical idea. But it's an idea that's so simple, you'll be like, oh, I would have thought of that. Sure you would. Joey thought, hey, instead of rendering both screens at once, why don't we just render them separately? I know, groundbreaking stuff here. But at the time, no one had thought of it. No one had even considered, why don't we fix the UI and that'll fix crashing issues on TVs? So we tested it out. And when you see it in action, you see not only is it faster, it's snappier, it uses less memory at the core. So naturally, you can't just make a UI change here at Netflix without, you know, having a good discussion with the product team and the designers. And like I said, designers here they're very fickle. They're very particular. They like that pixel perfect design. So when Joey went to them and said, hey, I want to actually make this screen, it won't look as good, but it's going to help people around the world. Naturally, they said yes. Of course, because at the end of the day, it's about the people using your device. It's not about looks. It's not about anything else. Does it work? Does it work for everybody? That's what matters most. But the takeaway from Joey is that we really need the freedom to explore. We need the freedom to hack. We need the freedom to tinker. If you want engineers to solve problems that they haven't seen before, well, you got to let them run free sometimes. Sometimes you break things, sometimes you don't. But sometimes you make such a simple takeaway that helps everybody. That's the Faster Things project. And now I want to talk about a project that is very near and dear to me, the Atticus project. And yes, that bird is just not very smart looking. That is deliberate. And to talk about the Atticus project, of course, I need to talk about the engineer behind it. So meet Ashwarya. Ashwarya is a senior software engineer here at Netflix. And Ashwarya works in this massive node application that we know colloquially as Shakti. Shakti is the application that I work in, that Michael works in, that Jacques works in. And Shakti it's the gateway to all web traffic at Netflix. But behind Shakti is this massive, massive series of interconnected microservices that we know as Netflix. Shakti is just one small part of that. And Ashwarya, she had many jobs. One of them is keeping me in line. And the other one is making sure that the code that I push and the code that everybody pushes works. So she wrote tests. Tests like this. Tests that tests moving from one stage to another on device in Spain. This is Spain. Or Mexico. Spain. Yes. Could be Mexico. Regardless, she wrote a lot of these tests, hundreds of these tests, thousands of these tests, all to keep Netflix.com up and running so that we don't ruin your evening or your date night or your alone night with your cat. It doesn't matter. But Ashwarya had a problem. You see, from all those microservices and all these devs always pushing code, if an API breaks, that means the test breaks. When the test breaks, someone has to go look at it. And she wasted a lot of time looking at tests that had nothing to do with code breaking. It was just the API that broke. In fact, at one point, it was so bad that we only had an 88% stability rate for our tests. That means if I ran 100 tests, 12 of those tests would fail, not because of the code change, but because a service downstream failed. And that's a problem. See, we need these tests. We push a lot of code. We're fairly productive people, except for me, obviously. But it wasn't that simple. It wasn't such a simple problem. And little did I know, did she know, that engineers before me had tried. Four or five engineers before me had tried and failed to solve this problem. And it was a big problem. It was a big problem, because it wasn't just one test failing. At any given time, there are thousands of tests running on Netflix. Right now, there are thousands of tests running. But at the end of the day, it might be up to a million. I don't know. Nobody has ever counted. So we needed a way to bring stability to this inherently unstable system. What you needed was some sort of foolish and naive engineer to take this on. So, oh. Yeah. Foolish engineer. I said, I'll do it. Because, of course, I knew none of the history behind it. And it's not important. I didn't know that people had tried and failed. I didn't even know what they tried. I said, I will take this on because that's the type of person I am. I am going to solve this problem. So what's the first thing you do when you think unstable APIs? What do you think? Anybody?
Mocking.
Yes, someone said mocking. Someone was giving a qualifier. That's OK. Mocking. Of course, that's the first place I went to. So for those who don't know, mocking is the idea of taking an API request and then putting the payload into a static file. You wait till the API is stable and you just copy it into the system. We just copy it into Shakti at some point. The problem with mocking is that what happens when the API is deprecated? Well, that means some foolish engineer would have to go through and manually update all these files. Now, I don't know if you know this, but I am lazy. I am really lazy, and I'm not about to go through and update all these files by hand. Because I don't, maybe I'll remind you, the complexity of Netflix, and there are a lot of API calls, more so than is humanly possible. So mocking was out. What's the next idea?
Auto-mocking.
Auto-mocking, I like that. Auto-mocking would be another word for record replay.
Yeah.
So the idea behind record replay is that instead of manually typing all this in, I make a record run. I record the API call, I save it on the disk somewhere, and then later, I just play it back over and over again. And when the API changes, I just record it again. That should work, right? That's what I thought. Foolish I was. Well, it won't work for several reasons. One of those is because for every API request we make, there are things that change. Things like a timestamp that have to be accounted for. OK, that's not that bad. I can deal with that. I am a smart person. I went to college one time. I read a book 3 years ago. 3 years ago. Yeah. OK, so let's say I account for that. There's still the other problem that API calls, well, in Shakti, we make them blind. Shakti actually doesn't generate any logic whatsoever. Either the user or the API generates logic. Think of Shakti more as a state machine that serves UI. So when we make an API call, it can actually return 3 different things, 4 different things, 10 different things, because Shakti doesn't care. Shakti is just this simple state machine that makes API requests and routes requests to where they should go. So that the end result of all of this is that I can make an API call, and it can return so many different things. So record replay was out, because what am I supposed to record? What am I supposed to replay? I don't know. So what's left? Nobody.
Delete the tests.
Someone said delete the tests. Yes, I wish that. where's Ryan? Ryan, can we delete the tests? You don't have any bugs if you don't have any code. It's very simple. No. So I did what I do when I'm stuck. I went to go talk to my manager. Meet Ryan. Ryan Burgess is an engineering manager here at Netflix. And I said, Ryan, I am stuck. I've spent a long time on this problem, and I've tried a lot of things that don't work. What happens if I fail? What happens if I can't make it work? He's like, that's OK, because remember, we didn't hire you to write code. We hired you to solve a problem. And if you learn a lot of things along the way, even if you fail, you've learned something, and you'll be better next time. Like, yeah, that makes me feel a little bit better, just a little bit, because the problem was I was at the edge. You ever been to the edge? You ever been to the edge of engineering? You know when you have that one problem in your head and you cannot get it out of your head? You read a book, you watch a movie, you're on a date. It doesn't matter. It's always in your head, and it pushes you because you're like, I know the solution's there. I know it's right there. If I can just, that's where I was at because I'd worked on this problem for so long, and I had it all in my head. You ever been up at 5 a.m. on a Saturday writing in your bathroom mirror because you have a solution? I did. Anybody been there? Just me? I guess I'm weird. I pushed myself so hard to solve this problem because not only did people tell me it couldn't be done, they said, Jem, it's not possible. People before you had tried and they couldn't succeed. It's just impossible. Netflix is just this inherently unstable system. We just need to live with it, move on, accept the status quo. Oh, I'm a different kind of engineer. That's not the type of person I am. But what I really needed was at least one person to believe in me. I found Ryan, and I found Ashwarya, and I found an entire team called SideOps, who their only job is to keep Netflix up and running. And I said, Jem, I don't know what crazy idea you have, but I think you're onto something. I know, I didn't even tell them what I had, but they're like, the way you're talking about it and the state of your beard and that crazy look in your eye, I mean, you probably have something, you're so close. We believe you and we will help you in any way we can. So that pushed me a little bit farther. Because the thing is, when you're standing on the edge and when you want to push people forward, what you really need is someone to have your back. Because you don't want to go too far. But when you look out and you see the potential, you see the bridge that you're building underneath yourself, and that very edge of engineering, that's that beautiful moment. That's that moment we all live for, that like, I try to describe to other people in other fields, and it doesn't make sense. Like, what are you talking about? That's weird. But the point is, I pushed, and I pushed because people believed in me. And I had a thought. I said, let's just take out the timestamp. Let's take out everything on every API request that changed that doesn't affect the actual results of the API call. And then after that, let's split up the API call. Let's split it up into the path and the query parameter. So I have two points of data. And then I'll take the test name. And then I'll take the method, the get, the put, the post, the delete. And then I'll do something so simple. And when it hit me, it was just like out of nowhere. I finally got it. It was that eureka moment. I just did something that I've been doing since elementary school. I just decided to count. I decided to count the requests. That was it. And then I hashed all of these. So every single request flowing into our system is hashed by these parameters. And then I record that. And then later in the day, I replay that. And in that way, I brought this stability to this unstable system. And I built this thing that is lazy. I don't have to write mocks anymore. I built a system that is scalable. I built a system that brought our testability from 88% to 99%. Not an easy task. And not only that, I saved countless hours. I should say me and the SideOps team. We saved countless hours of engineering time, hundreds of hours. Not just that, we made the system 33% faster, which of course is lots and lots of money in cloud compute time. I built this system, my system. It's called Atticus. And it's called Atticus for Atticus Finch from Harper Lee's novel, *To Kill a Mockingbird*. *To Kill a Mockingbird*, because I was done. I was not gonna write any more mocks. I'm gonna write a system that works now and forever. In fact, it's running right now, and I haven't even looked at it. I haven't looked at it in months because it just works. That's the kind of system I want—the lazy system—and that's the kind of engineer I am. And really, the takeaway that I got when building Atticus and that I learned about myself is that it's the code we don't write. I wasn't gonna write mocks. I wasn't gonna write a system that I had to update and maintain over time. And really what I got was the freedom to explore. I even talked to my director, Chris, and I said, man, I am struggling here. He said, what can I do to help? And I sat in silence for a while, and I said, nothing. You gotta let me do it. And he said, okay, I trust you. I believe in you. I don't know what your idea is, but I believe that you will solve this problem. At the end of the day, what is engineering performance? We saw three examples of people performing above and beyond. People with an idea. People that were empowered. Because it's a funny thing. You can't solve problems by hiring somebody. You're never going to solve the problem. That is very short-term thinking. What you need to do is empower your engineers to freedom to fail, to have freedom to explore and discover. Because the important thing is, behind every line of code, behind every feature, behind every bug, behind every single thing that we're going to write, is a person. It's an engineer. You empower those engineers. And that's how things work. Thank you.